When should you use Image Trace featuring Adobe Illustrator? Hey guys, Kerry Hawkins here with another VectorMade.com tutorial. Today I'm going to be talking about when it's appropriate to use Live Trace versus vectorizing something by hand. So when you do an auto trace or in Adobe Illustrator, what's called live trace, you're just allowing the software to automatically vectorize your image. But there are times when that's really helpful, and there's most of the time it's not. Most of the time it's going to actually give you a rather choppy looking image. But there are these times when it's probably easier to do a live trace than to do anything else, and it's probably going to look better. And I had one of those come up the other day, so let me share that with you. Here's an image a client sent me and asked me to vectorize. And as you can see, it's just tons of texture and pieces, and just, this is a nightmare to do by hand. You know, you almost can't do it because there's just such fine detail all throughout. Really hard to get everything just right. So for something like this, I recommend that you do a live trace and then just go over the outside edge of the shape of the letters, and then add the stroke, like this black stroke, on top of a live traced version of this art. Now, one thing I would note with an image such as this is you don't really want to have all these other pieces. Like, I don't want this shadow in here. I don't really want this part here, these other shadow areas. And it's kind of dull because the image itself is not very vibrant. It probably is in real life, but you know, this is a picture taken and then sent via email. So you lose a little bit of something in all of those transfers from medium to medium. So what I would do first is just come up here to Image Adjustments and do a Levels Adjustment. You can do a levels, like a layer if you want to make this editable, but I'm just going to do the quick adjustment. And then you're going to grab this right here. There are these three eyedroppers, and this is for black, this is for gray, and this is for white. And what you're saying is when you click on white, for instance, and I click this background, I'm going to tell Photoshop to make this white. Anything that's here is white, and everything else will balance out accordingly. So watch what happens when I click. Absolutely nothing. That's what happens because I didn't have it selected. There we go. See how that just, let's toggle back and forth. You've kind of got this much brighter, much more vibrant looking color. And then another thing you could do once you've done that is even play with these sliders a little bit. This is going to increase your darks. This is your mids, and then this is your light tones, which we'll probably leave those where they are. You can also click this preview button and see. I mean, I like the way that looks. That looks pretty solid. And then you could come up here and do an adjustment, brightness and contrast, maybe just see what auto does. Oftentimes that will be enough. Let's just see. Yeah, that's okay. We might even bump the contrast up a little bit more on our own. Just see what that looks like. I like having a little more contrast. Gets a little bit more vibrance. You can even do an adjustment vibrance if you need it to be a little bit more colorful. And I'll toggle that so you can see the difference there. That looks pretty cool. Saturation also can increase those colors. But I think we're getting a little bit too far away from the original when we do that. So let's just kind of drop that down to, let's flatten that out to zero. We'll just make this vibrance really high. And let's go with that. And I'm going to save this as SGN Photoshop file. Once you have that done, come in here. Let's place file, place onto an artboard. Let's do wherever I found that one. Well, it was here, I think, right? Let me make sure. Yeah, there's my SGN. Boom. And I'll just align that to the artboard real quick. Okay, there we go. So if you want to do a live trace of this, there are so many colors. that what you really need to do, and first, let me just say, before you live trace it, you should probably make a copy of it, just in case. So I just clicked and dragged with Alt to make a copy. But just in case you need to come back and make any edits or do a different setting on your live trace, that's a good habit to get into. I'm going to go ahead and go up here to live trace, image trace up here at the top. And I'm going to click on this to get these presets. And I think low fidelity photo is probably going to work pretty well. Let's click on that and just see. You can try any of these. These are kind of your color options up here. And then you get gray, black and white, sketches, stuff like that. I will say I rarely ever use anything except silhouette and a couple of these on occasion. But try them out, see what they do for you. And it does take a little while usually to get these things to render out, especially when you're doing high or low fidelity image, because there's just going to be a ton of shapes that this creates. And I have a pretty beefy computer. It still takes a little while. And then when you're done with this, you can actually go into settings and tweak things if you need to. But again, like on something this complex where really these shapes are ill-defined and it's not necessary that you get everything perfect. You just need the overall splotchiness of the original design to come through. In that case, I don't think it matters how much fine tuning you do on the live trace settings. I just don't think it's all that necessary. Well, here we go, almost done. And we'll see what it looks like. I mean, that's pretty much what the original looked like, right? You just now have, instead of pixels, everything's made up of little shapes. And of course, you're gonna get little remnants like this and this one here, things like that that are really annoying. And I'm gonna go ahead and hit expand because I'm happy with that. And I'm gonna go ahead and delete areas that I don't want, such as this. I don't want this. So I'm just going in with my direct select tool, hotkey A, and hitting the delete key after I click on or click and drag, make a selection, all of that. I just don't want these little shadows that appear. I want that back. And so you just kind of go through and do this, cleaning up these bits. You could go into the interior and clean that up as well. But anyway, you get the idea. I'm not going to go through all of this and because I've already done this. I'll show you the finished product. But after you get all that cleaned up, get all of these little shadows, another thing you could do actually is go to select same fill color after you've picked one of these up and do that. But if you're going to do low fidelity, high fidelity, pass, you're probably not going to. All of these grays are going to be a little bit different values. It's considering them all kind of their own color, so that may not work, but that's an option. Anyway, it's going to look about like that. And then what you want to do is grab your pen tool and create this black outline, because that looks terrible, right? Like, it's really, really choppy. It looks awful. It's not going to print well. It's going to look really just ugly and not clean. So what I would do is just kind of start somewhere here in the middle of this black, and click and then click again, come up here to wherever the curve is. I'm going to click and hold while holding shift and drag that out until the curve is about where I need it. There it is. I'm going to go ahead and hit shift X to switch over to stroke instead of fill. And I'm going to fill this with something like yellow so I can see it. And I'm going to bump it up a little bit too. Let's see, maybe a 10's pretty good. I'm going to go a little thicker. Let's just do a 30 for the purposes of this video. Now that may not work with your particular file if you're trying to go for realism, but I think 30 is great. It's going to cover up that edge, and then we'll make it black and you'll see that it just looks a lot better. But this is one of those cases when I think a live trace would actually be very wise, beneficial, and is the best way to handle this kind of artwork. Normally, I say no, because you're going to have all of these pieces, these remnants, these little just jagged edges. It just doesn't look very good. It looks like it's been live traced, right? But if you can doctor it up a little bit, so let's do that. Let's make it black. If you can do something like this, then like the swirl on the inside kind of looks okay because you've got a nice solid smooth edge on the outside of the, and I'll just delete that so that's out of the way. And then you just rinse and repeat and do that for all of these. Another time it's really good to do a live trace or image trace is when you have something complicated like this that's a silhouette. So the original image has tons of pieces in it. I mean, if you were to do this by hand, you're talking about, you know, making these kinds of moves forever and ever. And I mean, that, like, I barely did any, and that's going to take you 5 hours, you know, to do that, maybe longer. So, and no one's going to care, because this isn't about the detail. It's about the generic shape of the thing, right? And so if you click on this and go to image trace up here and go to silhouettes, it's probably going to give you the best result. Now, that's just by default what it looks like. Obviously, tree, very easy, very good. I find that coming into the image trace panel, and let me pull it over here from my other screen, is going to be your best bet. Click on advanced. Threshold is probably okay. We might lower it a bit. Basically, the higher this is, the more content it's going to turn black, and the lower it is, the less content it's going to turn black in the silhouette setting. And then on path, I find that 90 is a good number to start at. And I've got it set to, you know, preview down here, so it will automatically update those things. It didn't make a whole lot of difference on this one. And then corners, you can play with. Sometimes 90% is good too. I go back and forth on this one, 50 to 90. I like to reduce the noise because I actually, lower the noise reduction. So the higher this number is, the smaller the pieces are that are going to get removed. Let's see if 100 removes any pieces. Yeah, you see a few that disappeared. And if you're down to 1, the lowest setting, you'll see a bunch of small pieces come back. And I find that I like that typically, although some of these get really, really tiny. You know, this is super tiny. So you might bump it up to like 5 or 10 and see what that does. I'm going to do 10. I still see a few. Let's double it to 20. 20 is pretty good, because then you've got enough of those holes to make it look real, but not enough to be like a nuisance. You know, might look weird if you print it out, or especially if you're going to cut vinyl or something like that. but that's pretty much what I do. And let's see if threshold changes anything. If I go to 200, do we like that better? Again, you're just going to see a little bit more daylight through the leaves. 150, even more. 100. You know, a lot more showing through. So that's just kind of personal preference, up to you. But I find that's the best way to handle something like this. You hit expand, and there's the outline of the shape. You've got a cool tree shape now. And you didn't have to do it by hand. See? That is something you never want to vectorize by hand. But it's a great example. Silhouettes are very easy to bring into Illustrator and Live Trace, and especially if they have lots of kind of ill-defined jagged edges that no one's going to be able to tell the difference on. See, no one's going to go, that doesn't look like a leaf. They're not going to care. Anyway, guys, that's the tutorial. Please leave a comment down below. Like, subscribe, share the video. It helps me grow the channel. And I will see you guys in the next video.